Praise the Lord. Welcome to Fresh Manna Christian Center, our Sunday afternoon live stream service. Amen. We want to give God praise for allowing us to make it to be able to worship Him one more time together. Amen. It's always a benefit, amen, to be able to wake up and have your sound mind and your sound body and just to be able to lift your hands and say, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Amen. So as we're getting started here on the live stream, we want to invite you to, or encourage you to invite someone to come and join with us this afternoon as we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth together. And we just give God praise. We know this is Memorial Day weekend, and people are barbecuing and doing all those types of things, and honoring our veterans. And myself, I'm a veteran, honoring our veterans that have served in the military and so forth. And that's wonderful. But the one who we really should memorialize and give praise to is Jesus Christ. Because without Him, there would be nothing. There would be absolutely nothing without Him. We would be lost. We'd be like ships without sails. We'd have no direction. We'd have no purpose. It just would not be good. And so we want to magnify the Lord today in worship and in the Word of God and song and all those different things. And as I've said before in previous live streams, what we're doing now is kind of like making down payments. So when the Lord does bless us all to come under the house of the Lord together in the physical sense, we will have invested in it now with our faith and with our participation. So those who are watching, don't just because you're at home disconnect because you're at home. Let it be like you're actually in the venue with us. And we're here together, simulated, you know, turn the TVs down or whatever, and just simulate it as if you're actually here in the service, because we are one body. Even though we're divided up in many different locations, we are one body and one body. And if we can be unified, we can see the hand and the power of God come to pass. Amen. So again, we want you to invite somebody to come to our Fresh Manna Christian Center Facebook page to watch this live stream. Let them know now and that we're live streaming. If they want to be encouraged to just jump on board with us, and we believe the Lord has something to say to them today. Amen. We're going to have our opening scripture come from one of our ministers here at Fresh Manna Christian Center. Minister Travion Prayer is going to come, and we want you to follow along on whatever device or Bible that you may have in reading the scriptures. Minister Prater.
Praise the Lord. So we're going to, if you have your Bible, turn with me to Proverbs chapter 3. And we're going to start at the first verse and read all the way down to the fifth. Amen. And I'm going to start off and hope and pray that we all do it in unison. My son, forget not my law, but let thy heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall be added to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thy heart. So thou shalt find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. Thank God for the reading of His word. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. The word of God is truly wonderful, and it's forever settled in heaven. Amen. Praise God. We're going to go into some corporate prayer now. We want you to join with us in prayer as we become in unison in the word of, in the spirit of prayer. We want to be in the spirit. The Bible talks about praying, and then it says pray with all prayer. And so we want to get unified in our spirit today, because I believe God is going to do something great. Amen. I don't know what it is. Amen. You may end up shouting in your house, in your kitchen, in your living room, in the bathroom, in the shower or whatever, or what have, while the live stream is going on. But let's get joined together and be in unison in prayer. Amen. I'm going to ask Sister Smith, First Lady Smith here, to come and lead us in corporate prayer as we go before the throne of God together in unison. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Glory to God. We bless you. Amen. If you're watching there, amen, just type in, I believe God. Amen. Amen. I believe God answers prayer. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, for allowing us to see another day today, Lord God. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love, Lord God. If we look back over our lives, we know it was nothing but your hand that have kept us thus far, Lord God. So we rise today with a praise on our lips, Lord God. We rise today, Lord God, with a song in our hearts, Lord God. God, and we come, Lord God, seeking you today, Lord God. And we humble ourselves before you, Lord, that you would have your way, Lord God. Have your way in our homes today, Lord God. Have your way in our families today, Lord God. Across the world, Lord God, folks are celebrating, Lord God, and coming together, Lord God. But we pray, God, as we rally, Lord God, hallelujah, that we don't forget you in this day, God. We pray, God, hallelujah, that we would put our minds on you, God, that we will put our focus on you, Lord God, that we will put our attention upon you, Lord God, for you are the author and finisher of our faith. Glory to God. Lord God, we press past what we see right now, Lord God. We press past what we feel right now, Lord God. We press past, hallelujah, what the enemy is saying in our minds, Lord God, and we put our minds on you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We put our hearts on you, Lord God. We put our attention on you, Lord God. Because you said, Lord God, when the praises go up, hallelujah, the blessings come down. Hallelujah, glory to God. And so we make a decision today, hallelujah, to praise you. Hallelujah, although we are separated, we are united in spirit, Lord God. And we lock arms in the spirit today. Hallelujah, glory to God. We lock arms, hallelujah, glory to God. We unify ourselves. Hallelujah, glory to God, in the spirit of God. Hallelujah, where all things are new and all things are possible. And if you're watching right now, I just want you to say, just type in, all things are possible. Hallelujah. As we stand in prayer, all things on every level, all things are possible. On every realm, all things are possible. On every dimension, all things are possible. We speak life over our circumstances. We speak life over our families. We speak life over everything around us and attached to us. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, we say, have your way, Lord God. Not our will, but your will be done. Not our will, but your will be done. All across, hallelujah, as folks are watching, let your will be done, Lord God. Let your anointing, Lord God, touch every life that's watching today, Lord God. Touch married folks today, God. Touch single folks today, Lord God. Touch those that need a word today, God. Touch those that need a healing today, Lord God. Those, Lord God, who are standing in need, Lord God. Let your power flow, Lord God. Let your anointing flow, Lord God. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. If you believe that at home, just clap your hands, and all the way in the house, clap your hands and say, I believe God.
Oh, hallelujah.
Praise God. Hallelujah to Jesus. Amen. Everyone watching, just give God a big hand praise right there. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Come on, if you're watching, we want you to just give God a praise and a thank you and just tell him thank you right now. Hallelujah to Jesus. Glory to God. God, we lift you up. We bless you and we glorify you and we exalt your name above every name, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We want to go into our announcement portion of our service. Amen. I'd like to ask Sister Tana. She's the head of our fellowship committee. She's going to come and announce to you today about our 12 noon Zoom prayer call. Our 12 noon Zoom prayer call. Amen.
So, good afternoon, everyone. Praise the Lord. We have been doing an encouragement prayer call almost since the beginning of not being able to gather here as a body, as a way to keep us connected and encouraged during this time. And we want to make sure that you know about it and invite you to join us. If you haven't done so yet, please come and join us. It's Mondays, Tuesdays, and Fridays from 12 to 1. That's kind of a little new thing. So it's now every Monday, Tuesday, and Friday from 12 to 1. It's during the lunch hour. So if you are working, we hope you can just take that as your lunch break and just get it connected with us. It's encouraging. There's scripture, Bible questions and answers, testimonies, sharing, laughter, and prayer. And most importantly, prayer, because God is answering prayers, and we've heard miracles and testimonies of answered prayer during this time. If you have a prayer request, let us know. If you need the Zoom link, it is a Zoom prayer call, let us know, and you can invite your friends and family to join. And it's just been a great time in the Lord, and we hope you all will join us tomorrow at 12 o'clock.
Praise God. Amen. Prayer at 12 noon. Amen. I'm reminded of Apostle Paul and Silas. They prayed at 12 midnight. Amen. And the Bible says that the shackles fell from off of them and the prison doors was open. And so when God does answer prayer, hallelujah. And it has been a wonderful blessing. Like Sister Tana stated, we've been doing that ever since all this got started way back in March, early March. And it's been definitely the glue that's held everything together, the spirit of prayer. Amen. Another announcement we'd like to make, if you want to support us in giving or support the ministry in giving, rather, you can do so by scrolling to the Shop Now button on the Facebook page you're watching from, and that will take you to our PayPal page. And you can sow seeds, give a faith offering, or tithe at that point, and sow into the kingdom of God. You know, the Bible talks about when we sow into the kingdom, we can reap bountifully. Those reapings are not always in monies. They're not always in some type of financial blessing. But there's all types of ways God has to bless us. If we look at it like this, God is the God that created the heavens and the earth. And the universe and all that's in it belongs to God. There are trillions of stars, and there are multiple things that we have no idea what's out there, and yet God has it all in his hand. So when it comes to blessing, there are millions of ways God can bless us, millions of ways God can bless us, not just with money. That's just one way he blesses us back, but there are so many other ways that God can bless us. But the Bible says God loves a cheerful giver. That means we give because we're happy to give. We want to give. The widow gave her mites. That's all she had. And that little bit of mites that she gave, Jesus said that was more valuable than people that gave much more, because she gave from her heart. And when we give from our heart, it goes into the soil of God's kingdom. And then he opens the window of heaven and he pours the blessing back out upon us. So we want to remind you, let you know again, that if you want to support us, you can do this, rather support the ministry, you can do that by hitting the Shop Now button on the Facebook page, and it will take you to the PayPal page, and then from there you can give. If you're not comfortable with that, you can message the moderators in the comment section there on the Facebook and let them know, and they can send you the actual link to the PayPal page, and we'll go from there. Another announcement I'd like to make, amen, in preparation of us being able to come back together again and under the roof of the house of the Lord, we want you to be assured that we're going to do precautions, whatever precautions that are required. We're going to make sure that happens. So we will definitely make sure there are masks available and temperatures will be checked at the door to make sure that everyone is safe. And people can have a sense of feeling secure and that everything is going to be okay. So we will be providing for those who want the mask. It won't be mandatory that you have to wear one. But if you should choose to have a mask, they'll be available. And we will be, we have medical professionals that we will be checking temperatures at the door in an invasive way where you don't have to have a thermometer in your mouth and all that. But we will be checking temperatures because that is the number one or primary sign that something could have gone awry. And that's just so everyone can have a sense of security and feel safe. I believe in faith. That's what I stand on, faith. But so everyone can be comfortable, that'll be available as well. So that's what we're going to be doing, because we want everyone to feel comfortable to come to the house of God. And then when you get here, let God do the rest. That's his job. Amen. So that's what we're going to be doing. And so we'll be able to accommodate all those things because we want to eliminate all the excuses of, well, what are they about this and what about that? We want to eliminate all of that so we can come together and worship the Lord in the spirit of unity. Amen. Amen. So that's what we're going to do. Praise the Lord. We're going to go worship the Lord in song today. Amen. And we're going to lift up the name of Jesus. And I would encourage you to be a participant in this part. I'm not a singer, but those at the Fresh Battle Church know I often sing, but I don't have a singing voice. But I believe in making a joyful noise, and I believe when the heart is pure, God loves it. Regardless if it sounds like Donnie McClurkin or Michael W. Smith or whoever, if the heart is pure, God loves it. So we want you to join along with us as we worship the Lord in song this afternoon, and we give him worship and praise, and we glorify him. So let's all join and sing together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift those hands to the Lord. Father, wrap me in your arms. Father, wrap me in your arms. Father, wrap me in your arms, and father me. Father, wrap me in. Father, wrap me in your arms. Father, wrap me in your arms. Father, wrap me. Father me. Come on, lift those hands to Jesus. Lift those hands. Say it with me. Say it with me.
Father, in your arms.
Oh, oh,
oh,
oh.
Father, wrap
me
in your arms.
Can I get any worshipers in the house? Come on, you may be wounded, you may be hurt, you may be left alone. But he can be a father to you. Let him wrap his arms around you. Come on, just open your mouth. I don't care where you are. Come on, talk to him. Father, wrap me. Yeah.
Father,
me, father me, father me, yeah. Father me. Come on, you may be hurt tonight. You may be left alone. Your natural daddy may be gone. Your natural father may be gone. But come on, let our heavenly father wrap his arms around you and let him love you right there. Come on, come on, come on. Just talk to him. Lift those hands. Come on and say, father me. Father me, yeah. Father me, father me, father me, yeah. Take me in your arms. Hold me. Love me. Father me, yes. Father me, yes. Protect me. Provide for me. Love. Worship him. Come on, just worship him. Come on, just worship him. Come on, just worship and worship him, worship him, worship him. Come on, come on. Come on, you've been without long enough, but the Father is here tonight. You've been without protection long enough, but the Father is here tonight. Some folks that messed over you and picked on you, and folks that just done you wrong, but the Father's here tonight. He's here to pick you up, and he's here to put a little alcohol and little mechanical foam on your leg, and he want to heal you. He want to make it feel good and make it all better. Come on, let the Father just love you tonight. Come on, let him love you. Let him love you. Let him love you. Let him love you. Come on, tell him, father me. Father me. Yes, 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 yes. Come on, lift those hands to the Lord. Come on, lift those hands up high. Lift them up. The devil don't want you to do it. Come on, but the Father is on the scene. I don't care who started the fight, but you're about to win. You're about to get the victory because the Father, he's on the scene. Every devil's got to go. Every demon's got to go because the Father is on the scene. Yes, he's here. He's here. He's here. In the Mosha. 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 Yes, yes, sir. Yes, yes, sir. Demons are running. Devils are running. Oh, the Father's here. Yes, he's here right now.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise. Come on, everyone that's watching, just lift your hands and say, he's good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's a good father. He's worthy to be worshiped. He's worthy to be lifted up. And we glorify him and we exalt him and we bless him and we give him all the praise and all the glory. And we say yes to him. Hallelujah. For he is the King of Kings and his name is Jesus. And we bless the name of Jesus and we glorify the name of Jesus and we exalt the name of Jesus and we lift up the name of Jesus. For at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. We glorify him. We exalt him right now. Oh, Lord, those watching, I want you to just lift your hands just for a moment. Come on, just lift those hands just for a moment. And just love on him just for a moment. Hallelujah to Jesus. Come on, pour your spirit out. Be like the woman who broke the alabaster box and she poured out the valuable ointment upon our Lord and she anointed him. Come on, be like that and pour out your alabaster box of your worship right now. And just let it begin to rain on his feet and rain on his head and rain on him because you love him and he's glorious. Oh, we give him glory right now. Hallelujah to Jesus. We exalt him right now in the name of Jesus. And we lift him up right now in the name of Jesus because he is glorious and he is mighty and he is magnificent and he is wonderful and he deserves the glory and he deserves to be exalted and he deserves to be lifted up and he deserves to be exalted and loved and all the adoration we could ever give you, God. It's not enough to tell you thank you. It's not enough, Lord God, to tell you thank you for all the blessings that you've shown us and all the gifts that you've given us and all the breakthroughs that you've had provided for us and all the times you've bailed us out. We thank you, God, and we give you glory in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, Father, we pray that you would anoint this word today. Lord, that it would fall on the good soil of our hearts. Lord, that we wouldn't miss one drop of what you have to say to us this afternoon. Not one drop. And that you would build a hedge around our hearts and that we would have the ear and the spirit to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say to us today. Lord, we've been adopted into the family of Christ. So we're not a stranger anymore. We're not a vagabond. We're not wandering about. But we're part of the family of the Lord Jesus. And I decrease that you would increase. You are the King of Kings and I'm just a servant, Lord. And so we want to yield to you that you could have your way in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let everyone watching just say, I believe God. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Praise his name. And praise the name of Jesus. Amen. There's no other name better or greater than the name of Jesus. No name better than the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. You know, as we go through every day, we walk and we think about things and our minds ponder on all kinds of things and activities, memories, experiences. We are thinking machines. We think about events that have taken place years ago, in some cases decades ago. We think of things and we evaluate them on a daily basis. We evaluate them and we look at things and some things we kind of laugh at and we look at ourselves and we say, wow, I can't believe I did that one. And then some things we look at and we look at it and we say, wow, I don't believe I made it out of that one. How I even got out of that situation. And we do this regularly. You know, we regularly, as human beings, we think, you know, we meditate, ponder, whatever you want to call it, but we do it. And it's a good thing. It's a good thing. We reflect on all these different things. But someone reflects even more than we do, and that's God. He looks at every moment and every second of our life very intently. He looks at it. He examines it. He looks at the decisions that are made, the thoughts, the actual thoughts that were at that time. He is the original Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI. He's the original one. He investigates. He looks in on a regular, daily basis. And somebody will say, well, how is that possible? Well, because the Bible says in Hebrews 4:12 that the Word of God is the discerner of the intent of the thought and the intent of the heart. The Word of God tells us that every idle word is recorded in heaven. Our actions recorded in heaven. And God looks at these things. And he looks over them and he looks at us and he sees where we are. And then he sees the end game or the end plan for us, the final results. And as he goes over that, he sees his outcome of what he's predestined for us to do or happen. When we do it, sometimes we just see just that event rather than look at the larger picture of how it all works together, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Because we all have good experiences, bad experiences, and ugly experiences in our life. We all do at different junctures, depending, doesn't matter how old you are. We all have good things that have happened. We have bad things that have happened. And then we have some pretty ugly things that have happened. I was just talking in the barber shop the other day with my barber, and we were talking about that old saying, sticks and stones may hurt my bones, but words will never hurt me. There's never been a more inaccurate, wrong statement or phrase or slogan ever created in the world than that one. Ever created than that one. It is as wrong as two left feet. It is just absolutely wrong. You can break an arm, break a leg, break a back, break an eyeball socket, whatever. That will heal. But words can have a lasting effect that kind of just echo and reverberate for generations or decades and just go on and 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 on. And whoever came up with that, I don't know what they were thinking, but it is truly, absolutely not accurate at all on any stretch. And so when God looks at us and he ponders on us, he looks at even the angels, ask the Lord. They say, well, Lord, why are you with these people? What is this with them? Because they don't understand. The Bible says they look into man and they have questions about this salvation, this creation. They don't understand. They even look into it and they question. The scripture even says they question that. They're absolutely obedient to the Lord, but they, what is man that you're even mindful of him like that? Because they don't understand. They don't see what God sees. They don't see the value that God sees. They don't see the relevance of the people that God sees. They obey his commands and they do what he tells them to do. But they're not touched to see as he does. That's what makes him God all by himself. And when God looks over our life, which he does regularly, daily, that's what it is. There's many things that make him God. And another thing that makes him God is his ability to look at each human's life, all that are living at the same time, simultaneously all over the world in a moment's time. No supercomputer can do that. And he's been doing that ever since man walked the face of the earth. From the very beginning, God has been doing that. And he will continue to do that. When we get to heaven, we'll stand before God and our entire lifespan will be in a moment. It'll be an absolute snap of a fingers. Your entire lifespan, whether you live to be 50 years old, 150 years old, however old, it'll be that way. Well, how is that possible? Because God operates outside of time. There is no age in heaven, time. And so when he looks at our lives, he looks at it beyond months, days, weeks, and years. He looks at it through the scope of eternity and where we are and who we are. That's how he looks at it, not how we do. It's good that we ponder on our life. It is good that we look over things. It is good because I believe I said it on Thursday night that Christians should be learning machines. We should learn from every experience, the good ones, the bad ones, and the ugly ones. We should learn from every experience. There shouldn't be nothing that we don't learn from as a Christian. We should learn from everything. Everything. And as we learn, we become more knowledgeable. Then the scripture says, comes to life, we are not ignorant of Satan's devices. We're not ignorant of that. And that ignorant doesn't mean lack of intelligence. It just means unknowing is what it means. I want to continue today with a part two on last week's message of you are qualified. You are qualified. Now, everyone watching, I want you to point your finger at yourself and say, I am qualified. You are qualified. Amen. So we're going to go to the book of Ephesians, the first chapter, and we're going to start in verse number 3. Hallelujah to Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Amen. I need one of the brothers to come and, Brother Deacon, can we come and reposition this? Because it's kind of messing up the pages of the Bible here. Please, sir, come and just reangle that just a little bit for me. Hallelujah. That's all right. You're an internet star now. Just turn it just a little bit that way. Just a little bit. Let's see. A little bit more. A little bit more. There you go. That's fine. Thank you. Praise God. Amen. In the book of Ephesians, the first chapter and verse number 3. Thank God for good godly helpers. Amen. You can't run the thing without people willing to help. Hallelujah. All right. All right. Ephesians, the first chapter. And we're going to start in verse number 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who have blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he have chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. God has positioned us to be blessed. You were born in this world in a position to be blessed. Because God is eternal. He's eternal God. There's no end and there's no beginning to God. He doesn't have a starting point and he doesn't have an ending point. He is omnipotent. He's eternal God. Because he is omnipotent and he's omnipresent, his blessings that he has prepared for us, they avail, they land in our lives at present time and come to pass to the end of our time here on this earth, and we transition into heaven. God is eternal spirit. Eternal spirit. He can't be measured. He can't be calculated. He can't be figured out. No computer that Bill Gates or anyone else can make could ever figure God out, ever. He's God. And he goes beyond that. And that God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Now, there's several points I want to talk about today, and we're going to go through each one of them. The first thing he says, he has blessed us with spiritual blessings. That's pure doctrine of the gospel, grace, gifts of the Holy Spirit. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Just like you have sins of the flesh and sins of the spirit, you have blessings of the flesh and you have blessings of the spirit. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. A blessing of the flesh would be you get a new car. You get a new house. You get something tangible. That is a blessing of the flesh. Blessings of the spirit have to do with the gospel and the movement of God, the gifts of God, the anointing, the promotions of God, the Zoe of God, which is the life of God. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. That's why people cavalier, they casually throw, I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. But do we really understand what that means? What does that really mean? I am blessed. It means that you are positionally put in a place to where God rains down the eternal blessings from heaven to overshadow the footsteps of your life, whether it is a good point in your life, a medium point in your life, or a low season in your life. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. And one thing God, well, there's many things God don't do, but one thing I'm going to say he don't do, he doesn't take back what he gives. He doesn't do that. He doesn't give it and then take it. I know someone said, well, the Bible says the Lord giveth, the Lord take it. Blessed be the name of the Lord. What that means, when God says the Lord take it, that doesn't mean he says he takes it. He just moves his hand and let the devil come in. Because the Bible says the devil comes to rob, kill, steal, and destroy. And the only reason he can't rob you of anything is because God's hand is there. The only reason he can't steal anything from you is because God's hand is there. But the moment God moves his hand out of the way, then Satan comes to rob, kill, steal, and destroy. He's not happy with just stealing from you. He's not happy with just robbing from you. He wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy you. There was an article on the internet this week on Fox News about this guy and what have you. He was, I guess he died, and he was in a coma for a couple of weeks. And he said he went to hell. And he said he seen the devil, and the devil looked like, for those who follow the Star Wars movies, there's a character in the movie, one of those movies called Jabba the Hutt. It's a big blob-looking type thing. And he said the devil looked like that, and the blood was coming out of his mouth and all this stuff. And when he woke up out of the coma, he said there was a nurse in the room, and he asked the nurse, was he still in hell? And the nurse just didn't respond to him. And then so as you read the article further, he says, yeah, he said, you know, I did go there, but the devil wasn't, he's not quite as bad as I, you know, I mean, no. He said he's not all that good. So he's not really all that good. He's not quite as cool as I thought he was. Not quite as cool. Now listen to the language. He's not quite as cool as I thought he was. So I'm not going to do heavy drugs. I'm just going to do light drugs now. But I'm still going to listen to my satanic metallic rock music. I'm still going to do that. Well, you didn't go to hell. You didn't go to hell. Not at all. Because one moment in Satan's presence, you will be changed for the rest of your life. One moment in the Prince of Darkness' presence, just like one moment in the presence of Jesus Christ, you'll be changed for the rest of your life. One moment, if you see the devil face to face, you will be changed. And what that tells me is that the devil deceives and says, oh, I'm not that bad. The devil's like, he tries to paint himself like a lot of us. He's like, I got issues, but I'm not really that bad. You know, I do have my issues, but I'm really not a bad guy. And that's what he does. He likes to make it look like I'm really not that bad. You know, I got my issues. We all got issues. We all got problems. I got problems. I used to be Lucifer, and I messed up. Now I got some problems. And he waters it down because he wants to rob, kill, steal, and destroy. He wants to take the spiritual blessings that God has blessed you and I with. And sometimes the only way he knows he can do it is he's got to look not as challenging as we might think he would be. So he's got to water it down. So he's spiritual. God says, I bless you with all spiritual blessings. Pure doctrine. You know, it's a blessing to have the word of God in purity in your heart. That is absolutely a blessing. It's a blessing to know the grace of God. I wish everybody that was watching would say the grace of God. The grace of God is so powerful and so wonderful, and it goes so far beyond anything we could think or imagine. It touches us in so many different ways. The grace of God doesn't just cover us when we make a mistake. The grace of God is there with us throughout every day of everything that we have. Every place we go, the grace of God is there. It just doesn't cover us from death. It also opens doors up and gives us favor. It doesn't just block the bad things from happening. It also opens up and clears the pathway so good things can happen. It opens the door so the blessings can flow. And that's why the closer we get to God, the deeper we get in the grace of God. And the deeper you get in the grace of God, the more blessed you are. All gifts and gifts of the Spirit. Thank God for the gifts of the Spirit. So he starts off with those two points. We are blessed with all spiritual blessings. Now let's go to the fourth verse. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Point number three, he has chosen us. He has chosen us. Now notice the wording. He has chosen us in him. Not outside of him, but in him. That's why you're not a loner. You're part of the body of Christ. You're not by yourself. You're part of a bigger group than you could ever imagine. You're not walking this thing alone. You got more brothers and sisters and relatives than you could ever imagine you have. You have more people that are in this family than the biggest family on the face of the earth. He has chosen us in him. Not only has he chosen us, he's made us holy and without blame. God chooses us with knowledge that he already knows that what you're capable of, who you are, what you are, what your bad points are, what your strong points are, but he has chosen you. He has chosen you. And that doesn't mean that God doesn't have a delete button where he's going to delete you after he's chosen you. Once he has chosen you, he's chosen you with all of your inadequacies. He's chosen you with all of your frailties and all of our weaknesses and all of our ups and downs. Oh, I'm too big. God still chose you. Oh, I'm too dark. God still chose you. I keep taking two steps forward and three steps back. God still chose you. He has chosen us. Chosen us in him. Now look at that. Not did I just pick you, but I not only chose you, but I placed you inside of me. I didn't just save you, and so you're out there under salvation. I not only saved you, but I also picked you up and I put you inside of me. That's why you're blessed with all spiritual blessings. Because you're chosen, and you're chosen, and you're placed in him. Not outside of him, but in him. It's one thing to be a part of something. It's another part to be in something. I can go to a club and they can say, well, we'll let you be a honorary member. And as an honorary member, you have access to come and go, you know, and you can do, you know, you can come in our meetings and you can do this. Like though back in the cartoons, when I was a kid, I used to love to watch Fred Flintstones. I think that's what it was called, the Flintstones, Fred Flintstone and Barney and all those people. I used to love to watch. That was my favorite cartoon. And Fred was part of the Grand Poobah club and whatever, and they had to wear the water buffalo hats. For those of you watching, you might remember that. And so I used to love to watch that. Well, you could be an honorary member of that group, or you could be a actual charter member of that group. If you're honorary, you could just come to the meetings, but you don't have a vote in what goes on. You don't have a say in what goes on, but you can come, but you just don't have a say. You're just basically this there. But when you're actually a member of that group, now you get to be a part of everything that the group has to offer. Well, God doesn't just save us. When he chose you and he placed you in him. So therefore, every benefit and everything that God is, you become a part of that. Everything that God himself, every virtue that God has, every anointing that God has, every blessing that God has, every gift that God has, everything that God has, you become a part of that. Not just an extension of it, but a part of it. You become part of it because you have been chosen in him before the foundations of the world. You know, I love that because he chose me before I could mess it up. Before I could go out and mess it up, God said, you know what? I'm going to choose you before you get a chance to mess this thing up. So I'm going to pick you before there's an earth. You know, because some of you like me, you can mess up some stuff. You know, I can remember, I guess this is tell on Donald Day. I can remember I caught myself trying to make a cake one time years ago. Because my mom used to make these wonderful butter cakes, wonderful, wonderful butter cakes.
And I called myself one day trying to make the butter cake without the recipe. And let's just say that didn't turn out too well. It didn't go. I messed it up pretty bad. And it didn't work out well at all. And, you know, but God chooses us before we have a chance to mess it up. So when we do mess up, we're already in him. And so his grace already covers us. He said, I'm not going to let you get burnt. I'm not going to let you come into this world and then mess up and then I'll choose you. I'm going to choose you before there is a world because I know you're going to mess up. But at least when you mess up, you'll already be inside of me. So I already have you covered. So that's point number three. So point one, he has blessed us. Point two, with all spiritual blessings. Point three, he has chosen us. He has chosen us. That's point number three. Point number four. Let's go to the fifth verse. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. Wow. Now, predestined in the Greek means foreordained. Foreordained. So when he says he's predestined, he has foreordained us to be adopted. We were adopted not by Jesus Christ, but through Jesus Christ. That is atonement. It is the atonement. That's why there was no sacrifice that could be made that could be higher than Jesus Christ. No atonement could be made that could replace Jesus Christ. None. He was the highest. He was the pinnacle. He was the absolute. He had to be the sacrifice because the only thing that could be an atonement for God's creation, because God created it, was God himself. Since God created it, he had to be the one to atone for it. He was the only one that could sacrifice for it. Nobody else could do it. No human being can do it. He created man, and so he had to be the one to atone for man, to bring man back. And he did it because we were predestined or foreordained. Foreordained. In fact, let's hold your finger in Ephesians and let's go to Peter. Let me turn to Peter real quick. First Peter chapter 1. And we're going to go to verse number 2, and then we'll go back to Ephesians. First Peter chapter 1, verse 2 says this: elect, according to the foreknowledge of God, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto the obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied, all by foreknowledge. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us. Begotten us means to come from. Begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Now this is the part I love right here. Who are kept. Everybody watching, I want you to say kept. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. All of this by foreknowledge and foreordained. To be kept by him because we're in him. And we're kept by him through him because we're chosen by him. And we're blessed with all spiritual blessings because we are foreordained of him. The whole thing, all the steps, God has placed it in him, and every believer that is under the atonement. That's why the only one that could atone for man was God himself. That's why it said, I have to make a body. And that body needs to be a little bit lower than angels, but higher than man. It can't be equal with man, because if it's equal with man, then it won't be an atonement for man. But I'll make it a little bit lower than angels because I have to make it subject. The Bible says Jesus was obedient unto death. I have to make it subject. So I have to make myself just a little bit lower. Jesus was very much God. He was just as much God as God in heaven. But he knew he was the only one that shed blood that was absolutely pure. He was the only one that could atone. Because the reason why he knew he had to atone, because he had foreordained every one of us to be in him. And if he didn't provide an atonement, then every one of us would be lost. So he knew, I have to be the atonement. I have to be the sacrifice. I have to be the one. So as that atonement, because I've already predestined in every one of them to be blessed with all spiritual blessings. I've already chosen every one of them in me before the foundations of the world. I've already handpicked them and given and predestinated them by love. So therefore, I have to make sure they make it to where they're going to be. So I'm going to atone for them. I'm going to come down and I'm going to be the bridge over their troubled waters. I'm going to be the one that's going to make a way out of no way for them. That's why you are not by yourself. I don't care what it feels like. I don't care what it seems like. I don't care how difficult it is. You are not by yourself. There is a host of heaven that is with you. Not only are you in the body of Christ, and you have brothers and sisters and cousins and nieces and nephews and uncles in the body of Christ, not just your natural family, but you have the host of heaven and the angels. Notice the Bible says that the angels, they watch over the righteous. So you have the angels of God on your side, and you have the body of Christ on your side. And then not only do that, you have God himself inside of you. That's a triple layer of protection. You have the body of Christ. That's the men and women that are part of the Lord with you. That's one layer. You have the angels of the Lord that watch over you and keep you in all the ways of the Lord. That's the second layer. Then you have God himself that is in you, because you're in his body and he is inside of you. If you have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that is the third layer. That means you're protected on the front, the sides, and the back. You're totally covered. And so people say, well, why do I feel some things? Because we're in this world. That's why. That's why the Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them out of them all. You might feel some things. You go through some things, but you're part of a bigger body. You're part of an organism that's living and breathing. You're part of an organism that's growing and developing, and that organism is called the body of Christ, and you are in Christ. So, yes, you do feel something, because when you get up at night to go to the bathroom and relieve yourself, sometimes you stub your toe on the edge of the bed, and it hurts real bad, but you don't lose that toe. It heals up. And sometimes in the body of Christ, we stub our toe, and it hurts, and it don't feel good, but we're part of the body. Just because you get hurt, that doesn't mean you're not part of the body anymore. You're still part of the body. And when you're part of that body, you have a healing. Think about it. Using that same analogy, when you stub your toe and there's pain, now all the resources of the human body go to that area that's in pain to promote healing. And when you're in the body of Christ, when you're in pain, now God allocates the resources of the body of Christ to come to you and help promote healing in your life. Well, nobody called me. That don't mean nobody wasn't praying for you. That don't mean that, well, how do I know they wasn't praying? If you're still standing, that means they're praying. If you didn't lose your mind, and if you did lose your mind, if you got your mind back, that means somebody was praying. For the Bible says the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. God could have people that is, God, not could, God does have people that are praying for you and I. They're not even part of this continent. They don't even know about us. Never seen you, never heard you, don't know nothing about you. But God put you on their heart, and so they're calling you out. They don't have to know your name. All they have to do is allow their heart to be touched by God. So when you're hurting and when things happen, God allocates. He begins to send resources to your way because he says part of the body's hurting. So I have to go and reinforce the body. Part of the body hit stubbed his toe, so now I have to go and reinforce that area. And somebody might say, well, God was going to run out of reinforcements. God never runs out of reinforcements, because the Bible says in Luke 7:38, it's like a river of living water. It's always flowing. It never runs out. God can never run out. So he's got plenty of resources. He can never be stretched too thin. In fact, God's got overabundance of resources, and he wants us to pull some of this stuff down. He wants us to start pulling on some of this stuff and start using some of this stuff. Instead of relying on what we see, he wants us to start relying on him. Start pulling on some of those things down from him. Hallelujah. So number four is predestinated. We are predestinated. We have been adopted through Jesus Christ. Through Jesus Christ. We have been adopted. That's why we are sons and daughters. Come on Thursday night. I'm going to teach you something one Thursday night. God deals with Israel as servants, but he deals with the Gentiles as sons and daughters. He deals with Israel as servants, but he deals with the Gentiles as sons and daughters. You are a son and daughter. You're adopted. You've been adopted. Your adoption papers cannot be revoked, cannot be invalidated. They cannot be removed. They cannot get lost in a fire and the building burned down and have no record of who you were. Your adoption papers are in heaven. And when God has adopted you, he signed his name on that paper, and his name cannot be removed. That's why he said, I'll be with you and I will never leave you nor forsake you. David said, though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Moses was on the backside of the desert for 40 years, and he didn't even know anything about God. He was, the first so many years, he was dealing with Egyptology and all the things that had to deal with. And then during that 40-year process, he had to learn God, and he learned that God was a supernatural God, and he would stand with him. He wouldn't forsake him. So point number four is predestinated. Now let's go to verse number six. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us acceptable in the beloved. Point number five, we are accepted. The word accepted in the Hebrew means to take pleasure in, and in the Greek, it means to take with the hand. God has pleasure in presenting us to his family with a handheld of connection. So when he says we are accepted, that means God has taken pleasure in you. It means also that God has taken you by the hand and chosen you. And he's presented you. Imagine, let me make paint a picture for you. You're walking into a ballroom, and the ballroom is already full of hundreds and hundreds of guests, and everybody's dressed to kill. Everybody's just dressed magnificently. Everybody just looks beautiful and everything. And then the doors swing open. I'm painting a picture. And then there you are. If you're a woman, you got on the most beautiful bride gown. If you're a man, you got on the most handsome tuxedo. And there's Jesus Christ holding your hand, presenting you to the rest of the group. This is my beloved son, Donald Smith. This is my beloved daughter, Tana Montero. And then when you walk in, you're accepted amongst that family. They run up and they greet you, and they begin to shake your hand, and they begin to tell you how much they love you, and you are accepted. That's why nobody in the body of Christ, when you are in Christ, you are not rejected. You are accepted. We may have been rejected prior to that in our lives. We may have been rejected by our families. We may have been rejected by other people. We may have been rejected in relationships. But when we are taken by the hand of God and he presents you to the family of God, you are accepted into the family. You are accepted and you are embraced. And your brothers and your sisters in Christ, they embrace you. That's why it is one body. He says he takes us with the hand. You know, it's a wonderful thing to hold God's hand. It's a wonderful thing to hold God's hand. Because in God's hand, there's security. In God's hand, there's comfort. In God's hand, there's reassurance. In God's hand, there's protection. In God's hand, there's deliverance. In God's hand, there's healing. In God's hand, there's provision. In God's hand, there's covering. When God takes us by the hand, he brings us, and he accepts us. And as he accepts us, the body accepts us. Because the body is part of who he is, so you cannot be rejected if the head accepts you. That's why the Bible says he accepted Abel's offering, but he rejected Cain. One day I'm going to teach you about the spirit of Cain. Not today, but one day we're going to teach you about that, the spirit of Cain. But we have been accepted into the beloved. We have been accepted into that. You know, and for a lot of us, that's a change of mind. That's a change of mind right there. Because we've experienced a lot of rejection in this life. In fact, there's more rejection in the world than there is acceptance. In fact, now it's more divided, not just in the United States of America, but just globally. It's more divided than it's ever been at any other time. People are divided by race. People are divided by economic status. People are divided by gender. People are divided by education. People are divided literally by what street they live on. People are divided by all number of manner of different things. And if you're not part of, if you don't have this or that, then you may not be accepted in this group or that group. And there's such a division in the world, not just America, but the world. There's such a division in the world, so much division. But in the body of Christ, the real body of Christ, there's acceptance. You are my brother. You are my sister. We are in this together. When you hurt, I hurt. When you rejoice, I rejoice. Back in the day, in the old church where we have church, when someone would testify and they would share how the Lord has blessed them with whatever, the whole church would rejoice as if they were part of that blessing, as if they were the personal one that got that blessing, because we were, you realize that if it blessed my brother, then I'm blessed too. If my sister is blessed, then I'm blessed too. Because we are accepted, and we have to allow that mindset of rejection and lack of acceptance. We have to allow that to be pulled down. It kind of goes back to what we were talking about early, how the devil likes to kill, steal, rob, and destroy. Because he doesn't want you to think you're accepted. He doesn't want you to think that people love you for who you are. He wants you to think that you got to jump through a bunch of hoops and you got to do all these kinds of things. All we really got to do is just love God with a pure heart. And then the other people that love God with a pure heart will love us too. Because we're all part of the same body. So number 5 is accepted. Let's go to the 7th verse. Let's go to the 7th verse. The 7th verse says this. In whom we have redemption through his blood for the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Thank God for forgiveness of sins. Thank God. I'm going to say it again. Thank God for forgiveness of sins. Every time we make them, every time we have a mistake, a oops, a blow it, or whatever, thank God for the redemptive power of the blood of Jesus Christ. The redemptive power of blood of Jesus Christ. That when we call on the name of the Lord and say, God, well, I'm sorry, and we're sincere in our heart. Let me underscore that. We are sincere in our heart. The redemptive power of the blood of Jesus steps in and says, we're going to do away with that. We're going to remove that. So number 6. Is redemption. And God brings us back through redemption. Outside of him, we're lost. But in him, we're found. Outside of him, we don't have a direction. But in him, we have a purpose. Outside of him, we have no life. We are on a pathway off on a slippery slope. But in him, we are redeemed. That's why we sing the song, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. When you are redeemed, you can say, I am saved. I am under the blood. I am cleansed. I am whole. Yes, I'm not perfect. Yes, I make mistakes. Yes, I don't get all the things right all the time. Sometimes where I should dot the I, I don't dot it. Sometimes where I should cross the T, I don't cross it. But I am redeemed.
I've been redeemed. What have you been redeemed from? Death, hell, and the grave. I've been redeemed from that. I've been brought back from that. I've been positioned into the body. And because I'm positioned into the body, the things that used to have a hold on me, they don't have a hold on me because I've been redeemed. Because that blood is so powerful. I am learning so much about human blood now. Because my mother is going through a situation in her body, and it has a lot to do with the blood. And it's fascinating, human blood. It's absolutely fascinating how important the human blood is. How important it is. If the blood is not temperatured right, and they try to give you a blood transfusion, that could kill you. It can be the right type of blood, but if it's not at the right temperature and they try to put that in your body, that can kill you. Even though it's the right kind of blood, but if it's just not perfectly temperature to your body, it could kill you. It could be the same type of blood, but if you have antibodies in your blood, certain antibodies, it has to be the exact match of that. You could have a serious problem. Serious problem. There's so many things that the human blood does. There's so many things. It's a highway to remove waste, but it's also a highway that brings life. It provides oxygen, but it also removes contaminants. It strengthens and it nurtures and it repairs. The white cells are part of that. And the white cells are the soldier of the human body. They fight off viruses and sicknesses. There's so many things that blood does, the human blood, that's why we can't live without blood. We have to have blood. If one of your major arteries are cut, if it's not cauterized or sealed within a matter of a few moments or a moment, you die out. You die. You bleed out because so much blood is being lost. Well, the power of the redemptive power of the blood of Jesus Christ is full of antibodies. And those antibodies cancel out every sin, every problem, everything the enemy does. An antibody is something that works against an invader. And so the blood of Jesus is full of antibodies. And those antibodies attack sickness. They attack oppression. They attack depression. They attack rejection. They attack loneliness. They attack hurt. They attack loss. They attack poverty. They attack all the weapons of the enemy. Because in the blood, the redemptive blood of Jesus Christ is full of antibodies that go against everything the kingdom of hell can throw your way. That's why we are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And in that blood, you can stand against hell, and hell cannot overthrow you because the blood of Jesus has redeemed you and saved you. And it's a blood that no human could have shed. Only God could have shed that blood. And that blood is perfect, and it is full of everything that you and I need. Redemption. Redemption. Let's read verses 8. He, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having known unto us the mysteries of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation, of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Everything is in him. Now, dispensation has to deal with stewardship or garrison. Stewardship. Christ is the ultimate steward of our soul. And by him being the ultimate steward of our soul, he garrisons us or locks us in. That's why we have to work really hard to go against the will of God. We have to work real hard to go against the will of God. We have to literally, really purpose in our heart and deliberately work really hard to go against the will of God. We have to work real hard to do that because he stewards us. He garrisons us. He said, to the dispensation of the fullness of time. Well, during that dispensation, he has to steward. He has to make sure that Prater doesn't fall off. He has to make sure that Moten
doesn't fall off. He has to make sure that Kendra doesn't fall off. He has to make sure that Lynette doesn't fall off. He has to garrison. And that's why the unseen that's around us, what was it? Elijah told his servant, he said, oh, no. His servant got scared. He said, there's a whole army out here to kill us. And Elijah said, don't worry about it. There's more with us than there's with them. There's more garrisoning you than is against you. There's more surrounding you in light than there is darkness against you. We're in a dark world, but because we are garrisoned or stewarded by God, steward means to watch over. We are stewarded by God. He has to make sure that we don't go too far. We can push against his will. We can do some things. We really can. We're human. God wants to. We are free moral agents, and God does allow us to choose. But God also does say, you know what? I watch over my word to perform it too. And if you're predestined to be part of my body, you might may accept a little bit for a little while, and my grace will cover you. But there's going to be a time when I'm going to pull your chain and say, it's time to come on in. And I'm going to orchestrate the events of your life where stuff starts to fall apart, where you have to recognize, like the prodigal son, I need to go home to my daddy's house. The Bible said after he spent all his wealth and all his possessions and he lived a riotous life, he was at his lowest state and he was living amongst swine in a very debauchery type situation full of excrement and everything else. And he roses up and he says, you know what? I need to go back to my daddy's house. He had no expectation of how his father was going to receive him. None. All he knew is he just needed to go home. He just knew he needed to go home. He didn't know if his dad was going to chew him out, if his dad was going to wear him out, be like, you should have listened to me. What was wrong with you? I told you not to do this, blah, 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 all that. He didn't know what was going to happen, but he knew he just had to go home. And we know the story. So, yes, we can go and do some things against the will of God. Yes, we can. But if we've been chosen to be part of the body of Christ, God will wake us up and say, no, you're going to come home. I'm allowed things to start go awry in your life, start messing up because I'm trying to get your attention because I need to bring you home. So number six was redemption. I need to hurry. Let's go to verse number 11. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose, of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Number seven is inheritance. The inheritance that we now possess was pre-planned to be deposited in us. It was pre-planned to fulfill the will of God. It was pre-planned. You know, nowadays they have prepaid credit cards. And that's so you, I guess, so it can help so we don't spend too much money. So you get a plastic card and you put $250 down or $250. It's a credit card, but you've prepaid for it, so you can only spend up to $250. So it's prepaid. There's prepaid, I believe, phone plans and all type of prepaid things. And that's good and it's great. I'm not knocking it. All of it's great. I think it's really a great tool, especially if you have a problem with budget. It's a great tool to have. But God has prepaid for an inheritance that we would possess. He paid the price that we would have the inheritance. He's the one that said, put eternal life on their account. Put healing on their account. Put provision on their account. How much? I'm God. Let it never end. Put need meet on their account. Well, how many needs are we meeting? The angels say, all of them. For how long? Eternity. An inheritance. I've pre-prayed an inheritance for you. I've laid the foundation and I have paid the price. You don't have to work. You just have to serve and love me. All you got to do is just love me. The inheritance, I've already paid for it. It's yours. So number seven is inheritance. That inheritance has been deposited. It's deposited in us. You have a reservoir. The Bible says it like this. We now have this treasure in earthen vessels. You have a treasure in you because you've been chosen, and you're chosen because, and you're blessed with all spiritual blessings because you've been predestined, and you've been predestined because you've been foreordained, and you're foreordained, and you have that treasure, and you've been placed into the body of Christ. So number seven is inheritance. You are not broke. Everybody watching me right now, watching this telecast right now, say, I am not broke. You are not broke. You know what I mean? I don't have a dime in my account. You are not broke. I don't have this. You are not broke. You have an inheritance. And your inheritance will begin to speak to the different situations in your life. Your inheritance will speak to your lack. It'll speak to your brokenness. It'll speak to your loss. It begin to speak. Your inheritance will speak. The Bible says, write the vision and make it plain. You begin to speak your inheritance and you make it plain. And it'll begin to speak to the different areas of your life. It'll begin to turn things around. It'll begin to open doors for you. It'll begin to loose things that if you haven't been able to change for the last 20 years, it'll begin to change. Just begin to speak your inheritance. Begin to speak your inheritance. Our final one. Let's go to verse 13. And then we're done. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, unto the redemption of the purchased possessions, unto the praise of his glory. At number eight, the final one is you are sealed. You are sealed. Sealed. Because we are predestined, God brings us to a point where we are sealed. And by this seal, he brings us to a point. He brings us. God chose you and he placed you in the body. And when he chose you, that was with the predestined plan that you're going to be sealed. You're going to be sealed. So all we got to do is stick with the plan. Stay in God. Stay connected. You are sealed. When you are sealed, nothing that should get out gets out, and nothing that's corrupt should get in. Sealed. You are sealed. And somebody said, well, I need to get the Holy Spirit to be sealed. That's right. You do need that. But you can also be sealed if you stay close to God, to where you sanctify your mind and say, I'm only going to think on whatsoever is lovely, whatsoever is good, whatsoever is of an honest report. I'm only going to meditate on those things. I may not have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but I'm going to seal my mind. I'm going to saturate with my mind with nothing but righteousness. Instead of turning on KBLX or turning on the Pandora to Lil Wayne music or whoever, Lawrence Welk music, whatever kind of music, Barry Manilow music, I'm going to turn it on to nothing but worship music, and I'm going to saturate my mind so my mind is full of nothing but the glory of God, because I want my thoughts to be sealed in. I want my thoughts to be sealed up. I want them to be covered. So I'm going to create an environment. I may not have the infilling, but I'm going to create an environment so every thought of mine is completely sealed. So when I'm thinking on good, when evil tries to come, my mind is so focused on good, it only thinks of good things. When I do hear something negative, I got so much good in my mind, the good cancels out the negative. When something bad does come my way, because I built an environment and I am sealed, and before you know it, you step into being filled with the Holy Ghost, then you're sealed to the day of redemption. Redemption, my goodness. And when you're sealed to the day of redemption, now you're walking in the absolute power and authority of Jesus Christ. Eight wonderful promises. Let me recap. Blessed. He has blessed us. One. Two, spiritual blessings. Three, chosen. Four, predestined. Five, accepted. Six, redemption. Seven, inheritance. And eight, sealed. Eight is the number of new beginning. Six is the number of man. We talk a lot about that nowadays. 666, the number of man, that's the number of the devil. Seven is the number of perfection. God has given Jesus a name God gave Jesus the name Jesus. If you understand the name Jesus in the Greek, it works out to the number 8. The number 8 is above perfection and it's above the number of man. It's the number of new beginning. He has given us a new beginning, a new start, full of hope, full of virtue, full of breakthrough. He has given us every tool that's essential because we are chosen. I want to leave you with that thought. You are chosen. You are chosen. Nobody can take that from you. Nobody can rob that from you. You are chosen by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are handpicked and crafted by him. And he has blessed you with every spiritual blessing you could ever need. Everything you need, he has already given. That's why you are qualified. Because of these 8 things right here, you are qualified. Somebody asks you, do you meet the qualifications? You can say, yes, I do. Yes, I do. I'm blessed with all spiritual blessings. I'm chosen by the King of Kings. I was predestined by his perfect will. I've been accepted by his love. I've been brought back by his redemption. I have an inheritance that comes from heaven, and he has sealed me with the seal of his spirit. You are qualified. You are qualified. Everyone watching now, I want you to bow your heads. And I want you to do something we haven't normally done too much of in these telecasts. I want you to stretch your hand towards your device or TV or whichever way you're watching from. And I want you to stretch your hand towards it. And I want you to repeat after me and say, Lord Jesus, I am chosen. I'm handpicked by you. You've given me multiple proofs that I have been chosen. Your blessings, both natural and spiritual, have been in my life. Your grace has covered me time and time again. Your love has provided for me when I didn't even want to love myself. And I thank you. I am chosen. Those watching say, I am chosen. You are chosen. Chosen to show and bring forth the praises of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You are chosen to bring forth his glory and his purpose. For the Bible tells us in Romans the 8th chapter that creation is waiting for the manifestations of the sons of God. That's you, because you've been chosen. Now, Father, we thank you for your grace. Out of all the people that are living on this earth, you picked us. Make it personal and say, you picked me. You picked me. You could have picked anybody else, but you chose me. Thank you so much, God. And Lord, I want to live and walk in everything that you have said today. The predestined, the spiritual blessings, being chosen, redeemed, an inheritance, being sealed. I want to walk in those things, God. I want to live in those things. And Lord, I purpose in my heart to not look back, but to only look forward and to clothe myself with the spiritual blessings that you provided in the name of Jesus. And I want you to take 30 seconds now and just pray in your own spirit right now. Pray in your own spirit right now. Hallelujah. Pray in your own spirit right now. Glory to God. As we're closing out, we're preparing to close out. Just pray in your own spirit right now. Hallelujah. I can't put words in your mouth of what to say, but just pray in your own spirit, man, right now, in your own spirit, woman, right now. Come on, open your own spirit person up and begin to pray out right now. Begin to open up right now. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, begin to open up and begin to pour out. Come on, let it be like those rivers of living water. Come on, open your cistern and open your vessel and let it begin to flow out right now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. 20 more seconds. Come on, everyone that's watching. Come on, 20 more seconds of just opening your spirit, man. 20 more seconds of just opening your spirit, man. And just letting it flow. 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 Hallelujah to Jesus. Oh, praise God. Come on, 10 more seconds. 10 more seconds more. Come on, 10 more seconds of opening your spirit. 10 more seconds of opening your spirit and just letting it flow out. Hallelujah to Jesus. Oh, God, praise his name. Praise his name. Praise his name. And praise his name. Hallelujah to Jesus. Amen. God bless you. We love you. Amen. If the Lord don't come, we'll be back live streaming Wednesday at 7:30 for our Wednesday night Bible study. Please join us then if the Lord doesn't come. And if he does, we'll meet you in glory. Remember, we're building the kingdom of God one person at a time. God bless you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God.